The Bible are people we are inclined to call heroes of faith. These are people who at some point in their lives, or at maybe several points in their lives, acted solely by faith. They may have had a history, a personal history, of God doing things in their lives that built that faith for them, maybe even miraculous things. Or they may simply have known of God's work in earlier history prior to their own time. But at the time in question, all they had was confidence that God would do what He said He would do. Several of these faith giants are mentioned in the book of Hebrews, chapter 11. We know that chapter well because that's what it focuses on. For example, it mentions Noah. Noah was told to build an ark. Noah did not build an ark because there had been previous floods and people who built arks had been saved from the floods. He built an ark because God said, build an ark if you want to survive. He built the ark and God saved him in the ark. Abraham is mentioned in the same chapter. He left his homeland, left much of his family, left the gods of his ancestors. God promised him a big family. But at the moment of the command, and at the moment of the promise, God gave Abraham no miraculous sign to confirm the promise. He just said, go. And Abraham went. By faith. Jeremiah is, we're studying in Jeremiah on Sunday evenings. Jeremiah is not mentioned in Hebrews 11, but the list in Hebrews 11 is not intended to be a complete list of every person in Scripture who had great faith. And as we look at the life of Jeremiah, we will see that he certainly fits the description of a man of great faith. When God called Jeremiah to prophesy, Jeremiah hesitated somewhat because he considered himself too young for the job, or maybe because he considered himself too young to be taken seriously by the people to whom he was supposed to preach. But he accepted the call nonetheless. For the next 40 years, Jeremiah faithfully proclaimed the message that God gave him for the people of Judah. He was always opposed by the people of Judah, sometimes violently. He had few friends or supporters. God gave him a loyal secretary by the name of Baruch, but other than Baruch, Jeremiah's friends were few and far between. He had to have been a lonely man, at least as far as earthly friends are concerned. When God called Jeremiah, God told him that the whole world would be against him. Going back in Jeremiah chapter 1, we have a bit of a description where God is calling Jeremiah and he both warns Jeremiah and encourages Jeremiah. Verses 18 and 19, chapter 1. For behold, I have made you this day a fortified city and an iron pillar and bronze walls against the whole land, against the kings of Judah, against its princes, against its priests, and against the people of the land. They will fight against you, but they shall not prevail against you, for I am with you, says the Lord, to deliver you. He would be on God's side, but the kings, the princes, the priests, and the people would be on the other side. They would not ignore him, rather they would fight against him. And all Jeremiah had to go on was God's promise. I am with you to deliver you. Why did Jeremiah accept the call and why did he continue this thankless task for 40 years? Excuse me. It was by faith. But faith in what? faith in whom? What did God do for Jeremiah to reassure him that God was with him? I looked through the book, and unless I missed something, there is not a single miracle recorded in the book of Jeremiah. Now, God was still at work. Don't get me wrong. I'm not saying that God wasn't doing anything. But I couldn't find a single event that we would normally classify as a miracle. Jeremiah didn't part the Red Sea. He didn't part the Jordan River and walk across on dry land. He didn't heal the sick. He didn't raise the dead. And he didn't see anyone else do those things either. So, what kind of faith was it that kept Jeremiah going? Where did it come from? We often think, well, those days were a little bit different from our days because they had miracles back then. We don't now. Not in Jeremiah's case. And basically, this was the key. The God in whom Jeremiah believed was the God who would do what he said he would do. We're going to be primarily this evening in chapter 10 of Jeremiah. And in Jeremiah 10, Jeremiah simply describes the God he served. He's basically saying, this is my God. This is what he is like. And the description he gives justifies the confidence that Jeremiah had in him. And if we believe his description, then we start to understand why Jeremiah trusted him. Basically, Jeremiah was called to call Judah to faith, to believe in the God of heaven. Now, the option to the God of heaven were the various pagan gods and pagan practices. There was nothing unique about the idolatry of Israel or of Judah. We know there were frequent periods of idolatry in their history. There was nothing unique about it. They merely borrowed and copied the religious beliefs and practices and gods of their neighbors. They didn't make up new ones. They just took the ones that they saw all around them. I won't say that we can never learn anything useful from our neighbors. But when it comes to religious beliefs and practices, it is the most dangerous of temptations. We have to keep in mind that whenever we deviate from God's instructions in order to do things that God hasn't commanded or things that God hasn't authorized, it is always a matter of faith or the lack thereof. It's not just a matter of we did the wrong thing. We did the wrong thing because of a faith problem. Do we trust God or do we trust someone else? In the first 16 verses of Jeremiah chapter 10, we have a series of comparisons between idols and God. So if you have your Bibles handy, I'm going to point out to you how the description goes back and forth between this is what idols are like, this is what God is like, and then just keeps going back and forth doing that. Gives a description of idols, gives comparative description of God. Description of idols, comparative description of God. Verses 2 through 5, we have a description of idols, followed by a description of God in verses 6 and 7. We're going to go back and look at these a bit more closely in a moment, but I'm just giving the outline right now. Verses 2 through 5 describe idols. 6 and 7 describe God. Verses 8 and 9, we have more features of the idols, followed by God's qualities in verse 10. Verse 11, we're again describing idols. God is featured again in verses 12 and 13. Idols in 14 and 15. And God again in verse 16. But every time the approach is the same. This is what idols are like, and this is what idols and idolatry have to offer. This is what God is like. This is what God has to offer. The message was to the people of Judah to encourage them to make the right choice. But at the same time, even though it is a message, a lesson given to Judah, at the same time, it is an expression of the faith of Jeremiah. He is saying, this is what I believe. This is the God in whom I believe, and I encourage you to believe in the same God. But this is my faith. Jeremiah consistently chose God because the alternatives were so inadequate. Most of Jeremiah's comparisons and Judah's false gods are in the form of physical idols, you know, little statues, and we're going to get into that. But he doesn't start directly with idols. He starts with a different form of idolatry, at least not in the sense of statues when he starts. He starts by saying, do not be dismayed at the signs of heaven, in verse 2. Astrology is one of the oldest forms of paganism. Been around for millennia and is still with us. I didn't check the Kansas City Star, but I would guess you can look up your horoscope, the Kansas City Star, any day of the week. If you can't, go online, it's bound to be there. Astrology calls us to place our trust in the influence or the power of planets and stars. He says the Gentiles would be discouraged by the signs of heaven, because the signs of heaven would often give them bad news. Verse 2, do not learn the way of the Gentiles. Do not be dismayed at the signs of heaven, for the Gentiles are dismayed at them. As the great philosopher Bob Newhart was known to say, stop it! Stop it! The heavens declare the glory and the handiwork of God. The heavens are not to be worshipped as God. And Israel apparently didn't stop it. If you were on the same daily Bible reading schedule that I am on this past week, you read about the evil deeds of King Manasseh, king of Judah. Manasseh was the grandfather of Josiah. Josiah was the king when Jeremiah was called to prophesy. In 2 Chronicles chapter 33, we have a description of the idolatry of Manasseh, that Manasseh introduced very effectively into Israel. I'm going to read verses 3 through 6. We're in 2 Chronicles 33, 3 through 6. For he rebuilt the high places which Hezekiah his father had broken down. He raised up altars for the Baals and made wooden images, and he worshipped all the host of heaven and served them. Astrology. He also built altars in the house of the Lord, of which the Lord had said, in Jerusalem shall my name be forever. And he built altars for all the host of heaven in the two courts of the house of the Lord. Also he caused his sons to pass through the fire in the valley of the son of Hinnom. He practiced soothsaying, used witchcraft and sorcery, and consulted mediums and spiritists. He did much evil in the sight of the Lord to provoke him to anger. Let's take notice that both Manasseh and the people of Jeremiah's day were very spiritually minded people. They were not people who rejected religion. They were spiritually minded people. But they trusted man-made forms of spirituality instead of trusting the God who made man. Most of Jeremiah's descriptions, though, are of idols. He mentions the astrology part, the host of heaven at the beginning of his description, but then he quickly moves to idols, and that's where he parks for a while. Instead of going back and forth between the descriptions of idols and then the descriptions of God, I'm going to just cover the idols first. And then as we look at the verses about the superior qualities of God, we can just make brief references back to the idols. But keep in mind that throughout this passage, Jeremiah is comparing two products. And he's really saying, okay, here are the two options. See for yourself. We're just going to line up their qualities, two columns, side by side. See for yourself which one is the most convincing. I've categorized the qualities of these idols into five or six groups, just depends on how you break them down. But each of the qualities will then be matched up with a quality of God. And when you see them side by side, it's hard to imagine why anyone would have ever chosen the inferior option. But it happens all the time. And it's still happening after thousands of years. One of the qualities. Idols, by definition, are man-made. Verse 3, the work of the hands of the workman. Now, both Jeremiah and Isaiah really worked this idea over heavily multiple times. It simply defies logic that a man would make an idol and then worship as a superior being the idol that he has just made or that some other fella had made. Since idols are made by men, they are by definition less than their makers. Another quality, if you want to call it a quality, an idol is lifeless. It can't even stand upright on its own. He notes that they have to nail it down to some sort of a support to keep it from falling over on its face. How stupid is it to worship something and make offerings to something so totally lame? In verse 5, the New King James says, they are upright like a palm tree. The idea is valid. An idol just stands there like a tree bending whichever the way the wind blows without any power of its own. But if you're following in an NIV, it has the same idea but with a much more memorable analogy. It says an idol is as dumb as a scarecrow in a melon patch. That just rings right. You can remember that. And you can picture the scarecrow out in the middle of the melon patch with a crow perched on its head and the scarecrow totally powerless to do anything to chase the crow away. Idols can't walk, they can't talk. Jeremiah says, they cannot speak, they must be carried. Imagine letting your life be guided by an object that can't move unless you move it. It can't tell you what to do, meaning it is dumb in every sense of the word. The only ideas found in idolatrous religions are ideas that people have put into them. They have nothing of their own to offer. Idols are perishable, he points out. You make them out of wood and cover them with silver or gold, but in time the wood rots, and the silver or the gold tarnishes. Verse 14 says that they are futile, a work of errors. In the time of their punishment, they shall perish. Simply saying that an idol made out of wood won't last any longer than any other piece of wood. In short, idols have no value, no power of their own. They're totally dependent on the imagination of the people who make them and worship them. They can't harm you, they can't help you. The end of verse 5 we read, don't be afraid of them, for they cannot do evil, nor can they do good. The alternating paragraphs that I pointed out at the beginning show that the God of Jeremiah is all that the idols are not. And Jeremiah was strong because he was serving the God of the Bible. Now, of course, when Jeremiah lived, they didn't have the Bible in the same sense that we have it. They probably didn't talk about the God of the Bible. But as we understand the God of the Bible, that is the God that Jeremiah believed in. His God is the God that we find described in Scripture. Now, Jeremiah probably also knew about God from oral tradition. From Adam through Noah through Abraham, the works of God had been passed orally from generation to generation. But in addition to that, remember, Jeremiah began his ministry during the kingship of Josiah. Josiah was the king who ordered the restoration of the temple in Jerusalem to cleanse it of the abominations of his grandfather Manasseh. And while they were doing the restoration of the temple, they found the book of the law of the Lord. So we know that during Jeremiah's time, they were able to read at least something of the Pentateuch. Books like Genesis and Exodus. And even a little bit later, over in chapter 32 of Jeremiah, he refers directly to stories that we find in the book of Exodus. So we know that they had scripture available to read that told of the wonderful works of God and the powerful things he had done. And the God they read about was the pillar of Jeremiah's faith and should be the pillar of ours. This God beats the idols in every category. If this is who God really is, then it makes all the sense in the world to serve Him as faithfully and as completely as Jeremiah did. Four paragraphs there almost itemize. We don't have, it's almost a checklist. They just pretty much itemize God's greatness. First, there is simply no other God like God. Verses 6 and 7, we are in Jeremiah 10. Inasmuch as there is none like you, O Lord, you are great, and your name is great in might. Who would not fear you, O King of the nations? For this is your rightful due, for among all the wise men of the nations and in all their kingdoms, there is none like you. He is great, His name is great. There's none other like Him. There were idols. I mean, they reproduced those things as fast as they could make them. There were lots of them like the ones they had. There is no God like God. He is the King of the nations. This brings out another competing item of belief for Israel. One of Judah's problems was their belief in idols and therefore their worship and their trust in idols. But another one of their problems was their trust in other nations who might be their allies. And whenever they were threatened by one regional power, they would look for another regional power to become their ally and serve as a counterbalance to the other one. So they were trusting the nations. But God, He says, is King over all of them. So why not turn to Him? Then you don't have to figure out which one's bigger than the other. He covers them all. Verse 10 is a clincher. It says, the idols are simply weak, false gods, but the Lord is the true and living God. Verse 10, but the Lord is the true God. He is the living God and the everlasting King. At His wrath, the earth will tremble, and the nations will not be able to endure His indignation. The word Lord here is the word that the Israelites didn't say out of respect for God. The closest we can get to it is probably the word Yahweh. So every time I have Lord here, it's in, I don't know if this makes sense, small capital letters. It's not just capital L, small O-R-D, but it's like capital type letters. That indicates that this is actually the word for Jehovah or Yahweh. And He says, Yahweh is the true and living God, as opposed to the false and lifeless gods that Judah was currently worshiping when Jeremiah preached this. Verse 12 gives three significant qualities of God that were in direct contrast to the idols. First, He has made the earth by His power. So first of all, God, the God of Jeremiah, is the God of creation. He is not the fabrication of men. This is repeated down in verse 16 when it says, He is the maker of all things. This is important. It was fundamental to Jeremiah's faith that he was serving the God who made everything that is, just like we read about in Scripture. This is in contrast to verse 11. Thus you shall say to them, this is Jeremiah was to say to the people, the gods that have not made the heavens and the earth shall perish from the earth and from under these heavens. But our God made the earth by His power. Weak, inanimate objects are no match for the power of Jeremiah's God. He has established the world by His wisdom. For some reason, I seem particularly drawn, my attention is drawn to this item, because we often think of the power, the sheer power that it took for God to create the world. But I marvel even more at the wisdom that it took to create such a complex world. You can't examine even a single detail of nature without being impressed by the complexity of it. Mankind has not yet discovered a fraction of the marvelous intricacy of God's creation. The tail end of a verse we read earlier, verse 7, "For among the wise men of the nations and in all their kingdoms there is none like you," saying that His wisdom is greater than all of the wise men of the nations. Then He goes on in verse 12, "He has stretched out the heavens at His discretion." The NIV says understanding in the place of discretion. God's understanding complements His wisdom. It's not enough to create one astounding item of this world. It has to function in harmony with all the other complex items of this world. For example, if we had created the world, we would have left out all the natural disasters. We would have left out those fires in Colorado and all. We've left out all that stuff, and our world would be dead a long time ago by our design. What we call disasters are forces that rejuvenate and rebalance the resources to keep the earth viable. It took a wise and understanding God to imagine all that, and then a powerful God to create it. Jeremiah did not serve God faithfully for 40 years simply because Jeremiah was a very determined man. Jeremiah served God faithfully because the God he served was worth serving. And he knew it. If we diminish God in any way, it will affect how we live, how we respond to Him. If we remove from Him the qualities that the Bible says He has, we won't serve Him the way the Bible says to serve Him. The two go together. If we trust our own ideas or the ideas of other people instead of God's ideas, we still won't serve Him His way. Faith in a lesser God or a modified God will not produce the same results as faith in the God that that Jeremiah describes for us. Now, our faith is our connection with God, but our faith should not be faith in faith. We shouldn't be believing in faith. It's absolutely necessary that the faith we have be faith in God. Faith in any other God or faith in any other concept of God won't be the same and it won't be adequate. The power is not in our faith. The power is in the God in whom we place our faith. And that's where Jeremiah's strength came from, the God in whom he believed. I want to close by reading two other faith statements. We'll just read them, no comment. Still in Jeremiah, one of them is just across the page in chapter 9, verses 23 and 24. "Thus says the Lord." And remember, this is still Jeremiah showing the people of Judah, you have this option, you have this option, which is going to be, okay? Verses 23 and 24, chapter 9. "Thus says the Lord, let not the wise man glory in his wisdom. Let not the mighty man glory in his might, nor the rich man glory in his riches. But let him who glories glory in this, that he understands and knows me, that I am the Lord, exercising loving kindness, judgment, and righteousness in the earth. For in these I delight, says the Lord." The other one is over in chapter 17 of Jeremiah. Jeremiah chapter 17, verses 5 through 8. Thus says the Lord, cursed is the man who trusts in man and makes flesh his strength, whose heart departs from the Lord. For he shall be like a shrub in the desert, and he shall not see when good comes, but shall inhabit the parched places in the wilderness, in a salt land which is not inhabited. Blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord and whose hope is in the Lord. For he shall be like a tree planted by the waters, which spreads out its roots by the river, and will not fear when heat comes. But its leaf will be green and will not be anxious in the year of drought, nor will cease from yielding fruit. Jeremiah stood strong because he trusted in the Lord, the God of the Bible. If Jesus had been the son of some other God, it would make a big difference in the entire gospel message. The God of the Bible that we've looked at tonight, that Jeremiah trusted, he is the all-powerful, all-wise, everlasting God. He is the God above all gods and the King above all kings. It is that God's Son who died for your sins. That's why only Jesus can be our Savior and why only Jesus should be our Lord. If you need to trust Him to save you and to guide you in your life, do it tonight by obeying His instructions. Place your faith in Him. Turn away from sin. Be baptized because God promised that He'd take away your sins when you do. If we can help you, let us know while we stand and sing.
Above, and he bids us all.